from the highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and we know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God.
Who has told every lightning bolt where it should?
The depths of our hearts, and you love us the same. You are amazing, God. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Rich in love and you're slow to Good morning, everyone. Great to see you. You know, summer is kind of clicking away. But you know, we know that God is faithful. He is working in each of us. Life goes on. And, you know, one of the things that I'm learning is that I'm not sure everything I can tell you what God is teaching me, but my mom is on hospice right now, and I had a wonderful time yesterday on the phone with her, singing hymns, and my sister sent me a picture of her laying on her hospital bed with her hands up. And, you know, that's ending well is a good thing. And so we continue to pray for a powerful time of her going to be with Jesus. But in the meantime, I'm still learning things. And God teaches us, and I'm just praying that our hearts would be open to what God has to tell us today. Because, I mean, there's always fresh things from God, and you should be asking, you should be in your prayer life, and this just came to mind, but you should be asking all the time from God, is this all you have for me? Is this all there is to being a Christian? Is this all the joy that I can handle? No, really, really, we serve a big God, and He has good things for us, and it's okay to talk to him like that.
Peace.
You just want to fall into his grace. You fall into the grace of God. He's calling us. There's such a mercy, there's such a love, and he's calling us to himself. Let me pray. Father, I want to thank you for your presence here this morning. And I pray for that individual or individuals that are here this morning who just haven't really understood who you are, and maybe they haven't grasped your goodness, or maybe have been blinded by this world or by the one who controls this world, and they're just not aware of who you are and what you want to do in their lives. I pray, Lord, that you would open the eyes today, you would open our ears, open our hearts to what you have to tell us. Help us, Father, to know that You have a tenderness in your heart toward us, and you're calling to us. Help us, Lord, to hear you today. We thank you for your care and your goodness to us. Help us to be grateful. Help us to thank you often.
Oh, the weight of his glory. Oh, the wonder of his grace, the power of salvation. Pulls me from the grave, his hope is not empty. And forever he will reign, and he won't be put to shame. Oh, my soul, sing to the God of the ages, sing to the Lord of creation, sing his praise again. Oh, my soul, sing like the heavens are waiting, pour like an army of angels, sing his praise again.
From the moment of rescue, I have never been the same. His love took me captive, and my sin was washed away. I stand here forgiven, and I know that I am saved, and I won't be put to shame.
Good morning, church. So today we're going to be going through Romans 8, which is about, I talked to Dave a little bit, and he said that he's going to be speaking on that we get to, as Christians, now focus on positive things. And some of those things that we get to focus on, one of my favorite, and it ought to be some of your guys' favorite too, is communion. And so today we're going to be taking communion. We take communion every week here at Journey to remember what God has done for us. So I simply want to read this story for you guys and remember what we are told by the big guy himself. So this is Matthew 26, 26. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." and he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." This is what communion's all about. It's about this moment in history where Jesus told them what was going to happen, and then he did it. He fulfilled it. Jesus has died for our sins, and we hear this all the time, and this is just, it never gets old. It never gets old. So this is what we're going to do today. We're going to remember this, just as Jesus commands us to. We're going to, there's bread and communion cups at all the different corners of the room, so we're going to go to that, and we're going to take those, and you guys can take them at your own time. We don't take it, you know, all at one time. So let's pray, and we'll do that today. Dear Lord, thank you for this time that we get to remember. Thank you for being a God who is worth worshiping, who is worth praising, who is worth remembering. You are so worthy, and we just thank you that you sent your Son to give us a chance at a relationship with you for eternity. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Almost forgot to turn that on. Well, this is Family Sunday, so the kids stay in today. And if you need nursery, there's nursery available down the hall and room for twos and threes down there as well, and somebody will be down there. But the rest stay here today. So today we're speaking on Romans 8, as Tony had mentioned, in our continuing series through Romans and seeing what Paul has to tell us. And I'm going to start with a little story first. It's 1925, and a family gave birth to a boy. Of course, he was young. And they named him Lawrence. And Lawrence, as he grew, he loved sports and he loved baseball. And as he grew up, he was drafted by the New York Yankees. So here we've got a young man that is going out to play baseball, his passion and what he loved. And the war starts and he's called to war. And he volunteers in the Navy and he gets placed on a landing craft to run a machine gun. And he is at the invasion of D-Day. He's injured in that landing, but just slightly, and he goes on to fight as well in the southern France, in the invasion there as well. He comes home from the war and starts his career as a baseball player, and he's part of the greatest generation, according to some. It is a great generation. He plays for the New York Yankees for 20 plus years. He coaches after that. His name is known as Yogi during his playing days. And he's considered by some the greatest player ever because he has won more World Series rings than anyone else. He has 10 of them as a player. Another 3 as a coach. He played for a team that is considered by most as the greatest in all of baseball, the New York Yankees. His last year he played for the Mets across town. He was very successful in baseball. And he had a lot of funny sayings. He would kind of say things and people would get a chuckle out of it, like, "It isn't over till it's over." Or, "When you come to a fork in the road, take it." You know, those switch hitters up there, those guys are amphibious. And so he was known for a lot of his strange sayings and that, and he was still considered a very great player, but he doesn't have the recognition of a Mickey Mantle or Joe DiMaggio, but many consider him the greatest. You say, what does that have to do with Romans 8? Well, Romans 8, by many theologians, is considered the greatest chapter in the Bible. Now, you may have a different opinion. You may have something else. I know that many people really love Psalms 23. Many people also love the Sermon on the Mount. But today, we're going to look at Romans 8. So, starting at verse 1. "So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Jesus Christ." Isn't that amazing? That starts off, I mean, boy, this is really good. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That means we're not separated. We're not going to be held accountable. We're not going to be punished. That God loves us and he has given us an answer and we're not condemned. That's pretty good. "And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death." So we've been freed. We've been freed from that fleshly desire that draws us away from God and separates us. And now we have a Spirit that is guiding and directing us in our lives. "The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He He sent his own son in the body like the body we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. We could never live, as Paul talked about in the last chapter, which we talked about last week, without sin. As much as he tried in the flesh, he could not live under the law. He told us, I do the very things I do not want to do. Those are the things that I do. God gave a solution. He sent his son to bear our punishment for our sin. So verse 4, he did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us, who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. In the King James Version, that word follow is walk. So it's the way our flesh reacts, our body reacts. We make decisions that please our body when we're walking in the flesh. But now that we have the Spirit, we don't have to do that any longer. We can choose to follow God and be led by the Spirit. We have a choice. Typically, when we walk in the flesh, we want what we want when we want it. And that's what we pursue. Got a little story here of a man that I'm sure you've probably heard of, but you never thought would be in a sermon. Genghis Khan. The legend says that Genghis Khan, the Mongol king of the 13th century, was out hunting one hot summer day. We can kind of relate to that. This last week has been some hot summer days for us. He was with his favorite hawk perched on his wrist. Parched with thirst, the king sought out a source for a cold drink. At last, to his joy, he saw some water, drop by drop, trickling down over the edge of the rock cliff. The king leapt from his horse, took a little silver cup from his hunting bag and held it so as to catch the slowly falling drops. It took a long time for him to fill the cup, and the king was so thirsty that he could hardly wait. At last, it was nearly full. He put the cup to his lips and was about to drink when all at once the air whirled and the cup was knocked out of his hands, spilling the precious water on the ground. It was his pet hawk who spoiled his drink. It flew back and forth and a few times, and it perched on the cliffs above. The king picked up the cup and again held it to catch the drops. When it was half full, the thirsty king lifted the cup to his mouth. But before it touched his lips, the hawk swooped down again and knocked it from his hands. Now the king was angry. He tried again, and for the third time, the hawk kept him from drinking. This angered the king. "How do you dare act so?" he screamed. Then he filled the cup again, but before he tried to drink, he drew his sword, and when the hawk swooped down, the king struck the bird with a blade. "That is what you get for your pains," shouted the king. But this time, the cup had fallen out of his reach between two rocks. So the king climbed up the cliff to drink right from the source. At last he reached the top and beheld a pool of water. But what was lying in the pool and almost filling it was a huge dead snake of the most poisonous kind. The king stopped, forgot his thirst, and thought only of the dead bird lying on the ground below him. "The hawk saved my life," he cried. "And how did I repay him? He was my best friend, and I have killed him." How often, when we're walking through our life, do we kill that voice in our head when it speaks to us and says, "Go this way or go that way," instead of following after our own flesh? We squelch that voice just like Genghis did. But we go on. Those who are dominated by sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. Remember, we were talking about Yogi? Well, I got a story about Yogi as well. Ever since I've been in baseball, and that's been over 32 years now, people have had a lot of fun at my expense. Sports writers, fans, opposing players, and even some of my teammates have kidded me about the way I look, the way I run, the way I talk, and the things I say. The New York Yankees catcher wrote in 1976, "Razzing players on the other team is part of baseball. So when I was starting out in the minor leagues, the opposing players started hollering about how ugly I was." However, things did not change when Barra got to his big break in the majors with one of the winningest ball clubs in Major League Baseball history, the New York Yankees. "After I began to catch for the New York Yankees, they called me Neanderthal Man. A writer wrote that my face looks like a fallen souffle. They called me a comic strip character because I like to read comic books." Barra said, adding that he was not athletic or tall like his teammates. Others said I didn't look like a Yankee. "Every once in a while, someone will ask me, 'Yogi, how do you keep going and doing so well with fans and players are always making fun of you? How do you keep from getting mad, nasty, resentful, rattled?' Well, when I was getting started in baseball the way, and they would holler stuff at me, I was trying too hard to prove I belonged in organized baseball to really take offense at it." However, Barra confessed that the temptation to seek revenge or retaliate against almost overtook him on a few occasions. "Why is it that guys like that," he said, "always seem to have a foghorn voice that can be heard all over the ballpark? Some of our own men in the dugout started asking me, 'Yogi, aren't you going to go after him?' they said. And you know, once in a while, a player will get right up in the stands after a fan, especially out in the minors, if he just can't take anymore." However, Barra recalled the words and advice of a spiritual mentor, which allowed him to keep his cool. I wasn't saying anything, but I was really burning. I was tense and gritting my teeth. I peeked around the corner of the dugout to pick out the fellow that was in the crowd. Then all of a sudden, a quiet voice seemed to speak to me, and I recognized that voice. It was the voice of Father Charles Coaster, a priest in my old neighborhood parish of St. Ambrose in St. Louis, who is also auxiliary bishop there. Father Coaster is a great baseball fan and has been a valuable advisor to me all my life, Barra said. Now I seem to hear him saying, "What are you going to accomplish by trying to shut that man up by punching him in the nose? You'll just start trouble and get yourself riled up. You're paid to get hits and call pitches. Aren't you not, aren't you? Not to fight with people. Calm down and do your job, he added. So I just made myself cool off. The next time up at bat, I got a hit, and we ended up winning that game. After that particular incident, Barra recalled that he never felt an urge to fight back against the negativity. The things we learn, the people that we place around us can be an encouragement, and the Spirit is there always reminding us of what we've learned that is good and right and just. It's not just people of today. I look back and I was thinking of Peter as well. Then Jesus in Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 31. Then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. As he talked about this openly with his disciples, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Jesus turned around and looked at him, his disciples, then reprimanded Peter. Get away from me, Satan, he said. That's where a lot of people tend to quit quoting that verse. But if we look on that next line, he said, you are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Here's a man that walked with Jesus. And yes, he forgot. But God is there to remind us that he's always there and he wants what's best for us if we're willing to listen. As we move on, so, letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will. That's why those who are still under the control of their sinful nature can never please God. So those that are lost are lost. They're walking in the flesh, not in the Spirit. So they are going to do things of the flesh. I think we get caught up a lot of times in trying to avoid the wrong things instead of just saying, let's concentrate on the right things. If we're busy doing the right things, we won't be drawn into the wrong things. I'm not saying you're not going to stumble, you're not going to fall, you're not going to make mistakes, and you're not going to struggle. You are. But if you concentrate on the right things, the wrong things will fall to the side. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to Him at all. And Christ lives within you, so even though your body will die because of sin, His Spirit gives you life. because you have been made right with God. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. He's calling us to live in the Spirit. In Galatians chapter 5, starting at verse 16, we read, "So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide you, guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting with each other. So you are not free to carry out your good intentions. But when you are directed by the Spirit, you are not under obligation to the law of Moses." So if we're following the Spirit, we're not under obligation. We don't owe a debt to our physical form, this earth suit. And we can choose to follow the Spirit and its leadings. Now the next verse. "When you follow the desire of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, adultery, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God." So I call that the junk food of the flesh. As opposed to the next verse, "But the Holy Spirit produces the kinds of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things." So if we follow the Spirit's leading and we concentrate on the good things, the right things, it's a whole lot easier not to do the wrong things. And as we start to fill ourselves with the good things, it's easier to go back to that instead of going back to the junk food of the sinful nature. Verse 15, Romans 8, verse 15. "So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children." So remember, we are a slave to sin. And then Paul told us earlier, we are a slave to Christ. And now we are adopted sons and daughters of God. So we have an inheritance. Does a father ever want something bad for his children? Well, the children might think so. We continue on. "He adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father. For his Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his history, we must also share his suffering. Are there going to be tough times? Yes. Are there going to be tough choices? Yes. But what I love is if we jump all the way to verse 31, what shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Us with God is a majority. Gary Larson had a cartoon that he created, and you see it here behind me, where he portrays God being on Jeopardy, and you can see the reigning champion has no points. Well, Gary Larson is an atheist and is pretty bitter against God. But reading some backstory on his cartoon, he originally had given the Daily Champion some points. And he kind of thought about it, and he said, well, if it's God that's going against him, I don't think he's going to make any mistakes, and he's not going to let the other guy get ahead of him, because he knows everything. He knows all the answers. So he took his points away and put it back to zero. But I thought it was pretty interesting that he saw that, even though he's an atheist, that God is in control. As I said before, when you join God, you're in the majority. With that, let me pray. Father, we thank you that you've loved us so much, that you've adopted us as your children, that you've given the Holy Spirit to speak in our lives and to help us choose the right way. We thank you that you forgive us when we don't. We ask that we would grow ever stronger in our walk and in our thought life. Help us to remember your word and keep it forefront in our lives. And we ask this in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, Journey. I am here to give you a report on Vacation Bible School this morning, and then you will get to sing some of our songs with us. So I'm going to start by sharing some numbers with you. We had 87 kids registered. Our lowest day of attendance was still over 70. Clap for that, but clap for this one. We had 32 volunteers. They covered 6 classes, 3 rotations, the nursery, the registration desk, the worship rallies, and tech, and 12 of those 32 were youth. And in addition to those 32, we had 11 volunteers who worked with us for work days and on setup day, but didn't actually work during the week, but that was 11 additional volunteers. Of the 87 kids registered, 16 of them were only 3 years old. And 51 of them were here every day. 14 churches were listed as home churches in addition to Journey. Out of the 87 children we had, 14 churches were represented. 3 different families said that they were still looking for a home church, and 1 family splits their time between Fairbanks and California and scheduled their Fairbanks time to be with us for our VBS this year. We had a lot of fun this week. We laughed a lot. We learned a new phrase, attitude check. Good job. Let's try that one more time. Attitude check. Good job. We talked about prayer, and we talked about the reliability of Scripture. We learned that Actually, let me do it this way, because I'm gonna ask some questions. If you were a volunteer for Vacation Bible School, please stand up. Good job, thank you. If your name is Shannon or Kelsey, please stand up. Shannon and Kelsey are on the children's ministry team with me, and they put in countless hours this week, and they did a ton of work. And I am so very grateful for all of our volunteers and for our staff that worked so hard on Vacation Bible School. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have our Vacation Bible School kids and volunteers, if you want to, come up, and we're going to share some information with you, and then we're going to sing with you. So VBS kids, listen up. If you are in the sorry class, please come on up. Who are my sorry kids? Right up here, top step. Thank you, Elliot. Good job. Walking feet. All right. Who is a checker? Do we have any of my checkers class here? All the way across. Checkers. Is any of my Connect Four class here? Anybody from the Connect Four class? Here they come. Are there any Jenga blocks here? Jenga blocks. There she is. Jenga leader. All right, do I have any chutes and ladders? Okay, come on up. And do I have any dominoes? Good job. Right up here. Can you stand next to Annabelle? Right up on the steps. Good job. Well done. All right. To my bigger kids, I have some questions for you. What does propitiation mean? Close enough. Noah, tell me.
A sacrifice that was made in place of something else.
All right. What is the Bible?
The Word of God. The Word of God.
The Word of God. Good job. Tell me some things about Jesus. Jesus is, Eric.
Holy.
Holy. Jesus is trustworthy. Jesus is forgiving. Jesus is
powerful.
What else about Jesus? Jesus is God. Jesus is worth following. And who is Jesus for?
For everyone.
Jesus is for everyone. All right. What do you guys say? Should we twist?
Come on. Keep my head going, feeling close, love, clearly, keeping it all you got. job, kids. Good job. Yes, they are.
That they were going to get to dance on stage and that they were going to get to do it again on Sunday. They were so excited. We had such a really great group of kids this week. I want to leave you with two things. First of all, if you think VBS looked amazing and you want to be part of children's ministry, we need volunteers. I will be out by the table where there is a spinner that the kids will actually get to spin with permission today. So you can stop by there and sign up to volunteer with children's ministry. If you think VBS was maybe a little bit overstimulating and you're not really sure that that's something you want to do, but you still want to help, our regular Sundays are much more quiet, and we always need help in the nursery to snuggle on the babies. And so I will be at that back table if you are interested in volunteering with children's ministry. And the last thing I want to say is thank you very much, Journey. You guys have supplied us with cardboard and foam board and marbles and snacks and volunteers, and you did an amazing job, and we are very grateful. So thank you.
I'd like to get Kelsey and Shannon, will you come up here with me along with Natasha? Natasha, if you were paying attention, she said, I want to leave you with two things. We'd like to leave you with something, and all three of you ladies with something, and that is our deep, sincere thanks. Come on up here, gals. These three women, a version of the three musketeers, I think, or musketeers in the last week, have been busy, and they represent just a tremendous outpouring of effort and love and attention to kids. If you're here, I know we have some grandparents in the crowd and some family that came to see children and grandchildren. I hope you know that Journey Christian Church is a place that loves kids, don't we? And just a place that puts a great priority on raising young children. So thank you for the gift of their time, and thanks to these women. If you hold that. Mrs. Cookman, for you. Will you stand with me? Stand up. Thank you. Thank you both. Thank you. All right. Thank you. It's a great, a great tribute to have the standing O here at Journey, isn't it, for some great servants. Thank you.
Sing for joy. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. You're dismissed. I choose to.